Welcome wherever you are. For those of you who are looking at us, watching online later on, or have got the DVDs, we're really glad that you're part of this. We're sorry that you can't be part of us live, but together, may we know and feel the Lord's blessing, touch and presence with us wherever we are and whatever our life circumstances are. At the moment, let us pray and then we'll have our first song where we all sing together in our own homes. Father God, we thank you this morning that we can come together across the village, across our area here in North Suffolk to worship you. And we join in our worship with the angels in heaven and people around the globe to sing glory to you, to bring you glory, to bring you praise, to say you are worthy of all honour, praise and glory. We bow before you as our King and our Lord and God. We ask you that you'll forgive us as we come into your presence. We come through Jesus, asking that you would forgive us and clean us again from that which has tarnished us this week, our sins, offences against you. Thank you that Jesus died for us and rose again. And we thank you, he's in heaven and one day he's coming and we're looking forward to that day. And if we're not, Lord, then grant by the end of this morning that indeed we truly will be looking forward with great anticipation and hope to the return of Jesus. Receive our worship, then come to us in our homes, speak to those who need to be lifted up, lift them up, comfort those who need your comfort, reassure those who need reassurance, guidance for those who need that. Come to you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. So this morning, the first song that we're going to sing is a song by Casting Crowns. I don't know, you may or may not have heard of those. They're a group that sing songs, Christian songs and worship. And they have done a slightly updated version of a great classic. And I hope you'll enjoy this to start with this morning. It's called One Day When Heaven Was Filled With His Glory. And if you've been around church for any length of time, I'm sure you'll know the song. Pretty much the same words, pretty much the same tune, just one or two little tweaks in it. But enjoy this song because this sets us up for the rest of our service today, where we're going to go back to think about the return of Jesus. We're going to be thinking in our sermon, we're going to be part two of Until He Comes, thinking of the second coming of Jesus. And this song, I think, is a great way to start. One day when heaven is filled with His glory.
One day when heaven was filled with His praises, one day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men, my example is He. The Word became flesh and the light shined among us, His glory revealed, living He loved me, dying He saved me, and buried He carried my sins far away, rising He justified freely forever, one day He's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day. One day they led Him up Calvary's mountain, one day they nailed Him to die on a tree, suffering anguish, despised and rejected, bearing our sins, my Redeemer is He. The hands that heal nations stretched out on a tree, took the nails for me, 'cause living He loved me, dying He saved me, and buried He carried my sins far away, rising He justified freely forever, one day He's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day.
Forward to that, and we think, yeah, it's going to be a glorious day when we see Jesus again as he really is. Let's transition through. Before we come to devotions this morning, Peter will prepare us and share us some things to pray for. Stuart's going to lead our prayers, and Tina is going to read the Bible for us. But before we do that, let's just move into this time of devotion with another song, another hymn that's around kind of thinking of the coming of Jesus, thinking about heaven. It's a wonderful hymn, Stuart Townend's song. There is a hope. There is a hope that lifts my weary eyes, I think it says. And just for us to be thinking forward and thanking God for all that he is and the hope that we have. So let's enjoy this song, There is a Hope.
Sing this together.
There is a hope that burns within my heart, that gives me strength for every passing day. A glimpse of glory now revealed in meager part, yet drives all doubt away. I stand in me the hope.
Tina's then going to read the word for us. Thank you. Tina, do you want to introduce where you're reading from and that for us? Thank you.
Okay. The reading's taken from Matthew chapter 24, verses 36 to 51. However, no one knows the day or hour when these things will happen, not even the angels in heaven or the Son himself. Only the Father knows. When the Son of Man returns, it will be like it was in Noah's day. In those days before the flood, the people were enjoying banquets and parties and weddings, right up to the time Noah entered his boat. People didn't realise what was going to happen until the flood came and swept them all away. That is the way it will be when the Son of Man comes. Two men will be working together in the field. One will be taken, the other left. Two women will be grinding flour at the mill. One will be taken, the other left. So you too must keep watch, for you don't know what day your Lord is coming. Understand this, if a homeowner knew exactly when a burglar was coming, he would keep watch and not permit his house to be broken into. You also must be ready for the time, for the Son of Man will come when least expected. A faithful, sensible servant is one to whom the master can give the responsibility of managing his household, servants, and feeding them. If the master returns and finds that the servant has done a good job, there will be a reward. I tell you the truth, the master will put that servant in charge of all he owns. But what if the servant is evil and thinks, my master won't be back for a while, and he begins beating the other servants, partying and getting drunk? The master will return unannounced and unexpected, and he will cut the servant to pieces and assign him a place with the hypocrites. In that place, there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Amen.
Lovely. Thank you both. Thank you, Peter. Right. As I said at the beginning, we're going to go back to the subject that we were looking at a couple of weeks ago. And we were thinking then about the words in Corinthians, until he comes. And we're going to be thinking today about until he comes, part two. We're going to think about the second coming of Jesus again today. Last time we saw that the world is not going to end in chaos and disaster, either from nuclear catastrophe or global warming, slower but disastrous effect. We saw that the Bible tells us is very sure that the world will end as we know it when Jesus returns. When Jesus returns as king for a coronation, to be king over everything, to restore things to how they should be, to do away with sin and all its effects, and to replace it with only that which is good. And so that's where the world is going to end. That should in itself give us confidence. But today we come back to it and want to look at a few more of the details of what it's going to be like and the circumstances around Jesus returning to earth, and then draw some practical effects for our lives and how we should be living in the meantime. So the good news this morning is I've got two main headings. The bad news is that under each of those two headings, I've got five sub-points. So we're going to start by looking at some of the general things that this passage and chapter 25 draw out. So we're going to look at the passage that Tina read for us, and we're going to go into chapter 25. So we've lots of ground to cover. This is where we're going. These are the things which I want to show you that Jesus teaches in these verses here. There was no chapter divisions. This was just one long talk, often referred to as the Olivet Discourse. So it's one big long sermon, and we're just looking at one section. Five things we'll draw out. I'll show you that Jesus won't be coming back straight away. That's what he told us. He told us that his return will be sudden. He told us there will be both delight and dismay at the verdict that he pronounces at that time on every individual. We will see that there are only two destinies. Is that how you spell destinies? I don't know if I've got a typo there. There are only two destinies, and that we will go to at the end of time. It will either be one or the other. There's no third possible alternative. And the last one is that his judgment, his pronouncement of where we go, will be irreversible. So where he assigns us, where he says we're going, that is where we will spend all eternity. All right, so just keep those things in mind, and I'll take you through them one by one. The first thing that we said there was that his coming, that Jesus said that he will be coming back after a long time. His return will not be immediate. Let me just put myself back onto gallery view so I can see you as I'm talking to you. It gives me the best chance of being a, not exactly look you in the eye, but at least get a sense that I'm talking to a group of people and not myself. There was three times where in the passage, once where Tina read, and a couple of times in chapter 25, where Jesus in the stories talks about a long time, a long time. It comes up repeatedly. It's in the chapter that Tina read about the house owner that goes away on a business trip, and he's away a long time. That's chapter 24, verse 48. Go into chapter 25. There's a series of stories or parables that Jesus tells. First one is about 10 bridesmaids. And in the story of the 10 bridesmaids, five were wise and five foolish. And he says that the groom had went away and was gone a long time. And various things happened or didn't happen because he was a long time. And then at the end of, towards the end of chapter 25, verse 19, he gives a story about a businessman who goes away and he leaves his business in the hands of servants, people who worked for him. Five, three, and two different amounts that he gave them. But it says that the servant was, that the master was gone a long time. And we need to just connect those dots there. And what Jesus is saying to us is, don't expect me to return anytime soon. You see, and that's important. The fact he is coming, he is returning, but it was not going to be as soon as the people in his day, and maybe even in our day, sometimes expect. And when you think something's going to be a long time, it's very easy to think, oh, it's, or when you think it's going to happen, rather, and you expect something to happen straight away, and you get disappointed because it doesn't happen, you can think, oh, it's never going to happen. And when you start to think, oh, it's never going to happen, that's when, well, it's easy to fall into the mistake of thinking, well, it doesn't really matter what I do, how I live, what I say, what I think. He's not coming back yet anyway. And that was the point of some of his stories. Temptations, persecutions, when things get really hard, you think he's never going to come back. He's just warning. He will come back, but it is going to take a while. There's going to be inevitable frustrations in life, but don't be surprised. There's no sign that I'm not coming back. It's going to be a while, but you do need to be ready. By telling us it's going to be a while, he's just preparing us for reality so that we don't think it's strange. You know, Jesus said he's coming back and he hasn't done yet. Peter, in one of his letters towards the end of the Bible, picks up that very point. And it says that some people say, well, we might as well eat and drink and be merry because he's not coming back. Obviously, you know, he said he's coming back, but he's not come. Where is his coming? Peter reminds them. He says, look, he says, don't forget that with the Lord, a day is like 1,000 years. And so what seems like a long time for us, really, for God, it's just a, you know, it's a hair's breadth. It's a click of the fingers. It's a 1,000 years is like a day. He doesn't want us to despair. That's the point. He's just saying it's not going to be yet. So that's number one thing. He's coming. He won't come back straight away. The second thing he says, however, when he does come, it will be sudden. he talked about it being like in the time of the days of Noah, chapter 24, verses 38 and 39, in the days of Noah. And he talks about people being at work. Two chaps will be at work in the field, and two women will be doing their jobs. They will be grinding flour. And he says, when Jesus comes, they're going to be caught up to meet him, but it will be sudden. It will be unexpected. They'll just be about the everyday things of life. He says, that's how it was in the days of Noah. But despite Noah warning them that the rain was going to come, despite the fact he said, you need to repent, you need to get ready because judgment is coming, they took no notice. And so when the rain eventually came and the heavens literally opened and the ground opened and the flood came, they weren't ready for it. It was unexpected. It was sudden. And he said, people were horribly surprised. And he said, that's how it's going to be when I come again. It's going to be sudden and people will be surprised. They're just going to be going about their ordinary life. And isn't that what we see these days? People just think he's not coming. Most people these days assume that Jesus is a figment of people's imagination. And they live as if it's not going to happen. Even many people who would profess to believe in Jesus, and you know them and I know them, if you push them, they'll say, yeah, I believe in Jesus, but there is no sense that he's coming back and they're going to have to stand before him and he's going to, you know, bring a verdict on their life and the way they've lived and where they'll spend eternity. They're living just for today. So living for their work. They're living for their family. They're living for their relationship. They're living to make money. They're living to make money so they can go on holiday. They're living to make money so they can retire. Or they're just living to exist, to pay the bills at the end of the month. There's no thought about Jesus and the fact that he might be coming again. Like, not a care in the world until one day Jesus is going to surprise them. So it's going to be a while, he said to the original hearers. And by my book, that means that we're nearer to the coming of Jesus than they were, because we're 2,000 years hence. So I think it would be foolish for us to be thinking, well, it's still a long way away. We just simply don't know. But it will be sudden. And the third thing we said was that when he comes, there's going to be surprise and delight. Or there's going to be delight and dismay at what he says, at the pronouncement he makes. Now, we need to look in chapter 25 to see this. One of the images he gives is that when he comes, there's going to be a separation. You'll find this in chapter 25 from about 30, verse 31 onwards. He talks about separating the sheep from the goats. And he uses an image that they would readily understand, because that was a lot of farmers around in those days. Many of them would keep some sheep and they would keep the goats. They would come back at the end of the day and the sheep would be put one side in one pen, the goats would be put into another. And he says, when I come, that's what I'm going to do with people. I'm going to separate. There's going to be a separation, like a farmer does with his livestock. He's going to do the same with us. Some will be pleasantly surprised at which side they go. Others will be dismayed. He says, just have a look. If you've got a Bible in front of you, have a look at chapter 25, verse 33, if I can find it on here. Yeah, 33 says he'll put sheep on his right and the goats on his left. And then he goes through, says to the ones on the right, come, you who are blessed of my Father, take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you before or since the creation of the world. For I was hungry and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, you gave me something to drink. And he goes on and says different things that they'd done for him. And then verse 37 says, the righteous person will answer, Lord, when did we see you? When did we see you like this? When did we see you hungry? When did I feed you? When were you thirsty? And there's going to be surprise at what Jesus has said. There'll be some people who will be accepted by God and they weren't sure they would be, and they're going to be pleasantly surprised. There will, on the other hand, be those who will think they're going to be on the right side. And actually, Jesus puts them on the left and he puts them amongst the goats. And they're going to be unpleasantly surprised because they're going to be those who've lived life thinking, oh, it will be all right. I'll be in. I was a good person. I did this and I did that. And I believed in God and I was never a really bad person. But there are those people who Jesus says in verse 41, then he will say to those on his left, depart from me, for you are cursed, into the eternal lake of fire. For I was hungry and you gave me nothing to eat. I was thirsty and you did not give me to drink. I was a stranger. And they'll say, well, when did we see that? You see, when you didn't do those things. He said something quite similar in Matthew chapter 7, earlier on in his ministry. Matthew chapter 7, 22. He says there, look, there'll be many people at the end of time who'll say, Lord, Lord, I prophesied in your name. Lord, I spoke for you. Lord, I taught about you. Lord, I served you. I even did miracles in your name. And those people are fully going to expect to get into heaven. But Jesus says there are going to be people like that, religious people, to whom he's going to say, depart from me. I never knew you. This is incredibly solemn. There's going to be delight and there's going to be despair when Jesus separates the two groups of people. That's the third thing. The fourth thing builds on that. He says there are really only two destinies. He talks about here in this parable, he talks about the sheep and the goats. He talks about heaven and hell. At the end of the chapter, the last verse of chapter 25, verse 46, then they will go away to eternal punishment, but the righteous to eternal life. When Jesus returns, there's going to be this separation, but it will be separation to one of two places. There is no third place. It is either the delight of the Lord is paradise, as he describes it, with unlimited joy, limitless, unending pleasure, eternal satisfaction, eternal peace. Revelation is revealed as a place where every tear is wiped from their eyes personally by God. Everything that is good, there'll be nothing there that spoils it. No regrets, no suffering, no sadness, no pain, no death, no illness, no viruses, no separation, no harsh words. Just everything that is good and pure and wholesome and right. No trace of anything to break that sadness. That's where one group of people are going. The others, he says, are going to be separated from him to the place he calls hell, which is total separation from God and total separation from anything that would bring respite, anything that would bring joy, anything that would bring pleasure. And it grieves my heart so much when I hear some people thinking, well, I don't care. And they kind of say it blasé, and I don't think they even realize what they're saying, but they say, well, I don't mind if I go to hell because I'll have my own fun there. Hell will not be fun. Hell will be misery. It will be pain. Everywhere Jesus spoke about it. And I think it's important that we understand that this is not a church made up thing. This is, you know, when we talk about hell, we're talking about something that Jesus taught us, and Jesus is the one that knows all things. He's the creator of all things. So if anybody's going to know about it, it's Jesus. And he says, he describes it like fire and darkness and worms that never die. It's like being in destruction but never being destructed. It's being in fire but never being burnt up. Whether that's a literal thing or not, in one sense, it doesn't matter. What he's describing is the unending nature of that awful destiny. And Jesus says here in chapter 25 of Matthew, he says there's one of two places. There is heaven and there's hell. And they're both as eternal as each other. Two destinies. And he says, he's the one that's got the right. He's the one that's going to make the judgment. And then lastly, in this section, so the fifth thing in these chapters is that this judgment will be irreversible. It's going to be irreversible. The judgment itself won't be weighing up whether we're good or bad. We talk about the judgment seat of Christ, and I think sometimes that can give us the wrong impression. A lot of people imagine that when they stand before Jesus, he's going to pull out all the good things we've done and all the bad things we've done, and he's going to see which outweighs, which is heavier. Does the good outweigh the bad? And almost without exception, I find that people who don't understand the Bible, but say they believe in Jesus, think that's how it's going to happen. So as long as they're a good person, they'll be allowed in. That is not what it's going to be like. Judgment Day is going to be for the pronouncement of sentence, not for the judging of whether we're worth it or not. Jesus was very clear in John chapter 3, where he said that the judgment is already on people who reject him. So as long as we live rejecting Jesus, not believing him, not accepting him, not following him, that is our decision. What Jesus will do is when he comes, he will pronounce that, okay, if we rejected him in life, then he will reject us in death. It won't be whether we've been good or bad. It will be whether we've believed in him or not, whether we've trusted in him. Understand me carefully on this one. When I say about believing in Jesus, I would say without a shadow of doubt that everybody listening to this, probably watching this as well, believes in Jesus, because otherwise you wouldn't be interested in it. You've got some belief in Jesus. It won't matter whether you're a really good person and a little bit bad. That little bit bad will still keep you out. It's not a question simply of believing in him. It's a question of trusting him and depending on him to deal with the bad stuff in your life, the sins, the offenses against God. Those have got to be dealt with, because whilst there's one black mark in us, we're not going to get into God's presence. So it's all about whether we've trusted Jesus or not, and it will be eternal. That last verse again, they will go away to eternal punishment or eternal life. Two destinies. And his judgment, his pronouncement will be irreversible. So those are the five things. There's more in there, but those are five things. Now, I want us to go on. If those being the case, it must impact our lives. It has to. These truths, this reality, it must impact our lives. And chapter 25 really is, this is what it's about. How does this impact the way we live? What difference does it make to us? You see, he's not simply giving facts and information. He's describing things so that it makes a difference to the way his followers will live. It's not theory. It's not information to be debated about. They're not nice stories to fill a little bit of time. These are things which need to shape our lives. So, the second part, here we go. Here's the outline for you. How should we live in the light of these things? We need to be living trusting. We need to live expectantly. We need to live faithfully. We need to be serving Jesus, and we need to be serving each other. Trusting, expectantly, faithfully, serving Jesus, serving each other. If any of you are taking notes, you could just jot those things down as that's up on the screen, and I'll start to talk about the number one thing. Is that we need to be living trusting in Jesus. It's kind of what I've just been talking about, but this is the thing behind the story of the bridesmaids. Jesus told this story. There's a wedding going to happen, and he pictures it that there are 10 bridesmaids. We've got a wedding coming up. I think we've got 4 bridesmaids. This one has got 10 bridesmaids. And he says 5 of them were foolish and 5 were not foolish. 5 were foolish and 5 were wise in it. The thing that separates the wise from the foolish, what was the distinguishing thing? 5 were let in, 5 weren't eventually. Why? What was the distinguishing feature? 5 were ready and 5 weren't. And the ones that weren't ready were not allowed in. And there's some interesting things that go on, and I'd love to take this further, but I do want to get through all these things here this morning for our good. But these bridesmaids, they were 10 of them. They were probably all dressed the same. They probably all had bridesmaids' dresses. They'd probably all been invited by the groom to be brides, or by the bridesmaid, by the bride, to be that have that role. So they'd all been spoken to. They'd all accepted it. They'd all say, yeah, I'd love to be a bridesmaid. Thank you. They'd all gone on the day. They'd all taken their little lamps that they had as part of their culture. They all looked as if when the groom came, they would be let in. They started off so well. They all assumed it would go well, but something went wrong because he was delayed. The oil ran for five of them ran out. And they didn't have any reserve oil. Whereas the others had got some reserve oil, they were ready for all eventualities. You see, the thing that Jesus, and the ones that weren't ready had gone off to get some oil. When the bridegroom eventually arrived and he went into the house with the five that were ready, the others, the door was shut and the others are locked out. They come back and they rap on the door and let us in, we're here. And he says, no, it's too late. It's too late. What's the point of this story that Jesus is telling us? Well, there's lots in it, but it's accepting an invitation isn't the same as getting in. Accepting the invitation isn't the same as finishing. Do you remember Jesus told a story about a farmer who sowed soil? He sowed seeds in the soil, four different types of soil. And in some of them, two of the soil, it started to grow. The seed started to grow, but then it didn't get anywhere. And he's saying that's what we can be like. We can start well. We can show every enthusiasm. But then for some reason or other, we don't carry on. And he's not interested in whether it starts to show. It's the carrying on. It's the persevering. It's the getting there. It's the being ready when he eventually comes. Not whether we've signed a card or whether we've been baptized or whether we've affirmed and said we believe in Jesus. It's, are we living for him? Are we living trusting Jesus? Remember those people in John chapter 7, depart from me, I never knew you. It's possible to have all the show of religion. We can be coming to Zoom. We can be getting baptized. We can go to church when it's open. Those things aren't enough. We've got to trust Jesus and we've got to trust him till the end. It's not even enough to be baptized. Got to follow him to the end. And an unwillingness to do those things, an unwillingness to obey Jesus and to keep obeying him casts a question on whether we're really trusting Jesus and believing him as Saviour and Lord. So there's a challenge for us this morning. There's a challenge for each of you in your homes. Will you carry on following Jesus? Will you carry on trusting him? Because it's only those who keep to the end that will get in. That's the first thing. We've got to keep trusting, living, trusting Jesus. The second thing is we do need to live our lives on a daily basis in the expectation of Jesus coming back to earth. We need to live our lives living in the light of this event. Those of you who had children will know what it's like. You get the scan and you find out that you're gonna have a baby. And the next 8 months, usually it's about 8 months, isn't it? When you find out, and not 8 months when you find out, once you found out, you've got another 8 months to go. But for those 8 months are lived in anticipation that your life is about to be turned upside down. Usually first child particularly, it's full of anticipation. Life is only going to get better. When you get the children, you realize actually that's the start of the fun. But the point is this, that you live planning for that. And that those last 2-3 weeks when you've got the due date, And those last couple of days, and you're expecting and you're living. And I remember when Andrea was having the children, it's like not being very far away, waiting for a call and then staying around home. And I think something's happening. And all the anticipation, you know it's going to happen, and everything goes on hold. The whole life is driven by knowing what's about to happen. And, you know, that's, in a way, that's how we should be living. The fact that Jesus is coming, because when he comes, it will change everything. And we need to live in the light of that, expecting it. Jesus told the story of he said, look, when I come, I'm going to be like a thief in the night. And if the house owner knows when the thief is going to come, he'd be ready for it. He said, I'm going to come like a thief in the night. We need to live our lives. This is the point that he's making. We need to live our lives in the light of his coming. Now, some, when if they think of a thief, they'll be going around checking and locking every door and every window and from a town. Having lived in a town most of our lives, Andrea tries even harder when we go out to make sure that everything is locked up and everything is done. Coming out in the country, it's been quite an eye-opener. I can go around to people's homes, I'll knock on the door and they're not there, and I'll try the handle and the door is open. I won't tell people on here who it is that I've been round to, but I found in the country that people are a lot more lax in their security. You know, if we knew there was a thief in the area, sometimes I watch on Nextdoor, you know, the app on the phone, and I'll see things like a dodgy van or dodgy people around. And when we know that, it's so that we can take care. Well, Jesus is coming. Let's make sure that we live our lives in the light of that, so that we live our lives thinking, what would Jesus like it if I was doing this? If he comes again and finds me doing that, will that be good? Will he like that? Would I be proud of it? It will help us in terms of when things are not going well. The fact that Jesus is coming again. So that will help us when we're scraping along the bottom. It should give us hope. It's not always going to be like that. It will help shape our priorities and where we put our time and our effort and our energies and even our money. Would we want him to find us doing this, spending our money, going to that place when he comes again? Well, our whole lives will be lived expectantly. It's really practical. When was the last time you thought about your decisions in the light of Jesus coming? Third thing, and I've kind of touched on this already, the need to be following, faithfully following Jesus. We need to live our lives faithfully following Jesus. Jesus told us, gave the picture in chapter 24 about the servant. He said that if a master goes off and leaves his house in charge of a servant, it's a wise servant that does it well and treats people well. It's an unwise servant. This is chapter 24, verses 45 to 51. It's an unwise who thinks, oh, he's going to be gone a long time. I can live it up. I can use and abuse what he's given to me. The point is, we need to be wise followers, wise servants, faithfully following. This is what Jesus wants. He wants us to be faithful followers of him, not thinking, well, it doesn't really matter. He's gone. He's not coming back anytime yet. The fact that he's coming back, we should be living every day, faithfully, doing as much as we can, living as closely as we can to him. I was reminded this week of a lovely old hymn as I prepared this, and I'm just going to read it to you. Some of you will remember this, and you'll say, I love that song. Take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to thee. Take my moments and my days, let them flow in ceaseless praise. Take my hands and let them move at the impulse of thy love. Take my feet and let them be swift and beautiful for thee. Take my voice and let me sing only, always for my King. Take my lips and let them be filled with messages from thee. Take my silver and my gold, not a mite would I withhold. Take my intellect and use every power as thou shalt choose. Take my will and make it thine. It shall be no longer mine. Take my heart. It is thy throne. It is thy own. It shall be thy royal throne. Take my love. My Lord, I pour at thy feet its treasure store. Take myself and I will be only ever all for thee. It's the essence of what Jesus is talking about here with these faithful servants. These two servants are faithful or the unfaithful. Fourthly, not only do we need to be following, but we need to be serving Jesus well. A separate story, and it's easy to muddle the two up, but in chapter 25, verses 14 to 30, he talks about the parable of the talents, the landowner who goes away and he leaves his affairs in the in the hands of three servants. This is the image in the story. One had got 5 talents, one had got 2 talents, and one he gave one according to their ability, to what he knew that they could do. Interesting story, because we know that the one that had 5 made 5, the one that had 2 made 2, but the one that had 1, well, he went and buried it because he lived in fear of the master. He was afraid of making a mistake. The story goes way beyond simply expecting and watching and waiting for Jesus' return. It's really focusing on, what do we do with what God has given us? What do we do with the opportunities that God gives us? What do we do with the talents and the gifts and the abilities and the resources that God gives us? Sometimes we can make the mistake of thinking that our life is about hanging in there, and it's about just being faithful. It's about just keeping going, just surviving until he comes. Well, for some, that can be the case. There are times in life when it is simply a question of hanging on. But most of the time, Jesus has given all of us, he's given you and he's given me gifts. He's given us opportunities, and he wants us to use them. It's our responsibility to use them for him. You see, all that we have, it belongs to him. Everything you have, everything I have, I don't own it. I'm a steward. Everything belongs to God ultimately. He's just privileged me to have a few things for a time. What you have, your time, your effort, your energy, your gifts, your talents, your businesses, your jobs, whatever, they belong to God ultimately. And it's, how do we use those for him and his kingdom? How do we leverage them for maximum good and maximum glory for God? My time is not my own. If I have any spare time, well, I thank God for that, but my time is his and it's to be used for him. My money ultimately is his. It's not for me to choose how do I want to spend it. First thought must be, what would God want me to spend this on? That's what this parable is about. We need to be serving Jesus faithfully and well. Then lastly, we also need to be serving each other. And I come to this from where Jesus tells about the sheep and the goats and the separation of one from the other, and the surprise that some of them have at being accepted or not. He's not saying that you'll be accepted or not by virtue of your good works, but he is saying that if you are a follower, you will be doing certain things, and you will be treating people in a certain way. And they're surprised. They say, well, when did I see you hungry? When did I see you thirsty, Jesus? You say, when you did it for the least of one of my brothers or sisters, you did it for me. When you helped a Christian, when you helped a brother or sister in Christ, when you served them, when you helped them, when you gave to them, when you provided for them, when you wrote to them, when you supported them, when you nurtured them, when you encouraged them when they were feeling down, all those phone calls, do you know what? You're making those to me. We need to be faithful in serving God's people as well. He's very clear here. You did it to the brothers and sisters. You did it to me. I think 6 times he says, you did it for me. When I was in prison, when I was this, when I was that. Now, Jesus is in heaven. It wasn't him. It was his people, but it's so tied up with him. When we serve other people, we're serving Jesus. As we wait and anticipate for Jesus' return, he expects us to be involved with his work on earth. He expects us to be serving each other, helping each other. He expects us to be involved in our church, in our local church. You see, church isn't, according to what Jesus says here, it's not just a question of turning up on a Sunday at 11 o'clock and listening to some songs, or going to church when, God willing, we can get back to a building and meeting together. Being part of his people is about being involved. It's about actively playing our part. It's about serving where we can. So there's a challenge. How do we live in the light of the fact that Jesus is coming again? Yeah, we live faithfully. We live expectantly. We must be living trustingly, but we're to serve Jesus and we are to make sure that we're serving each other. 50 times in the New Testament, it uses the little phrase, one another, 50 plus times, about being together, about helping one another. If you're a Christian, please, please don't just leave the local church to the others. If you're a follower of Jesus, you need to be involved with it. He's given you gifts, he's given you abilities, he's given you character, and he wants you to be part of us. If you're not part of the church, if you're not really playing a part, please, please, as we get back to normal, play your part. Even now, you know, do you think of giving a call to someone, sending a card to someone, you know, doing something that will encourage someone else? Have you thought about offering you some of your time as we go forward to serving one way or another in the church? It won't make you a Christian, but if you are a Christian, if you're a follower of Jesus, then we ought to be doing these things, because as much as we do them to the least of the brothers, we do it for Jesus. Serving in the church, or is all our time taken up doing our own things? Looking after only just the things that are ours, our families, our homes, our jobs, our careers, our enjoyment, our hobbies. How much time do we give to Jesus? Now, I'm not saying this to be harsh, but I'm drawing this out in the light of what Jesus says here. He's coming again, and he says we need to be serving each other. He doesn't say to these people, because I see the amount of time that you gave to this or to that. It's how much time did you give to the kingdom, to the people? So much here to be thinking about. If you're not trusting Jesus, then please do trust him before it's too late, because we never know when we're going to appear before him. We might say, well, he's not going to come yet because certain things haven't happened, but we don't know when we're going to appear before him. Many of us are at an age where we're seeing our friends and our relatives leaving this life. Those of you who are younger probably know people your age that have been suddenly taken down, taken out of life. We can't assume we're going to live forever. We need to be ready, because when we stand before Jesus, that verdict is going to be given. Did we trust him or not? And it will be left or right, heaven or hell. So do take seriously and trust Jesus today. Ask him to forgive you. Pledge yourself to follow him, and you will find the great life that he brings for you. Jesus is coming, and that should be for all of us a hallelujah moment that he's coming. It's not always going to be like it is. Let's make sure that we're ready for him. Let's make sure that we're trusting. Let's make sure that we're living. Let's make sure that we're following. Let's make sure that we're serving both him and each other. Okay, let's finish. There's enough there to keep us going, I hope. Chew over it. If you've got questions, you know you're always welcome to ask me. Email, drop us a line, give us a call. Put a question in for the question and answer. We can do some more on it. But I hope that God's encouraged us with the fact that he's coming back to us again. There's a lovely song I want to finish with this morning. Song by Lou Fellingham, There Is a Day. Let me get my words on here. There is a day with that all creation's waiting for, a day of freedom and liberation. And on that day, the Lord will come to meet his bride. And when we see him in an instant, we will be changed. What a wonderful day that is. Enjoy this song as we listen to this as we finish.
There is a day that all creation's waiting for, a day of freedom and liberation for the earth. And on that day, the Lord will come to meet his bride. Thank you. that will remain now for all eternity. Though trouble's hard, it's only
to things as yet unseen. Though trouble's hard, it's only momentary, and it's achieving our future glory. We will meet him in the air, and then we will be like him. We will see him as he is. Then all hurt and pain will cease, and we will be with him forever. And in his glory, we shall live. You know what I'd ask if we were together in church, don't you? I'd say that needs an amen. It needs a hallelujah. You could say it at homes if you like. Father God, we thank you for this wonderful truth this morning, reminding us again from your word that Jesus is coming, that these hard times will not last forever, that actually they're achieving weight of glory. They're doing something for us, and we have hope, we have glory, we have life to look forward to. We have Jesus returning. Please help us to live in the light of that. Help us to be ready. Help every one of us to be trusting him and living for him. Help us to live expectantly, shape our lives by these things, that we would be like the wise and the faithful servants to hear the well done, good and faithful. Come and enjoy the kingdom, the glory, the paradise that's been prepared for you. God, we thank you for your word. Thank you for the hope that's in it. Would you bless us and keep these things in our mind, and may they lift our souls the rest of today. And as we go into this week, in Jesus' name, amen. Amen. God bless you all.